Welcome to the Mean Lady Talking Podcast. This is the podcast that tackles tough questions about relationships, life, love, and loss. It may not be the advice you want, but it's probably the advice you need. And now here's your host, grief therapist, motivational speaker, relationship expert, best-selling author, and attorney, the not really mean lady herself, Susan J. Elliott.
Good day, everybody. This is Susan Elliott, host of the Mean Lady Talking Podcast, and today is Friday show. We have listener email. Now, this is a really cool set of letters because they really parallel each other, and one is from a woman and one is from a man. So I'm really excited to get to these letters. Before we begin, I just want to remind everybody to please rate and review the podcast on whatever platform you listen to. If you listen on Google Play, they don't have review ability. I don't know why, but they don't. So one thing that you can do is you can go to Stitcher. Stitcher has a really cool review tool that I really like, and you can also listen to the podcast there. You can also go to the Mean Lady Talking Podcast Facebook page and leave a review there, or you could do any or all of the above. So, or you could go to SoundCloud or TuneIn. There is a variety of places that I put on every one of the show notes. There's also a page on the gettingpastyourbreakup.com blog where if you look above in the black strips, there's a few different podcast pages. So you can go on any one of those pages and find the different platforms where you can listen. And reviews and ratings really help the show. So I want to continue to do this. So if you enjoy the podcast, please rate and review. Thank you so much. Okay, here we go. First, a letter from the woman. Dear Susan, I've enjoyed your books and videos, and I'm a member of the Facebook group. My boyfriend left me 3 months ago, but has contacted me on occasion, and the last time he asked if I would consider reconciling. I said I would think about it, and my best friend said I was crazy. She couldn't understand why I would even think about going back to somebody who has lied and who has cheated and who regularly calls me names. The only thing I could tell her was because I love him. She says that is not good enough. I know you don't typically talk about reconciliation, but do you think that because I love him is not a good enough reason? My best friend says she still wants to be there and support me, but she refuses to talk to me about any future relationship with my ex. Please help. Okay. The second one is from a man. Dear Susan, I really enjoy your books and videos. Thank you. My girlfriend is one who goes in and out of my life. She seemed to be confused for a long time, but I loved who she was before she started to question what she wanted. In parentheses, he writes, a life with me. She's a good person who had many bad relationships before me. Whenever we get too close, she tends to run away. When I first asked her out, she explained that she was getting over a previous abusive relationship and wasn't interested. I asked her to let me know when she was ready. A few weeks later, I ran into her and asked her out again. She again said she wasn't ready, but I pestered her into agreeing to just have dinner with me. We went to dinner, we had a great time, and after that we started to see each other regularly. Whenever we would get close, she would pull away, sometimes starting an argument for no reason at all and being verbally abusive by calling me names and insulting me, my job, my family, and my friends. When I would ask her why she was acting like this, she would say, I told you I wasn't ready, but you harassed me until I gave in and agreed to have a date with you. But she's confused. It's not like she's done anything worse. Although she can be verbally abusive, she's never cheated or been physically abusive. When she breaks up with me, she refuses to take any of my phone calls. My friends and family think that I'm wrong for giving her chance upon chance upon chance, but they don't know her and they don't love her. I do. How can I convince them that she's a good person and that part of her issue belonged to me pushing her too far too soon? All right. Well, I'm going to answer both of these letters in the same way. Each of them say, because I love him, because I love her. And because I love him or I love her, that's not a reason for anything when someone has hurt you, especially if they've hurt you badly and continue to mistreat you or fail to respect you. The first letter is from a woman who says that her ex lied and cheated, and she wants him back because I love him. That's confusing to me. Which part of lied and cheated do you love? I'm sure that if I had this woman in front of me, because over the past 25 years, I've had many people like this. And I'm sure, based on my experience with others, I would ask her, what parts of him do you love? The parts that lie or cheat? I've had clients say to me, you don't understand. He's more than just a liar or a cheater. Okay, but that part, the lying part and the cheating part, still exists. And there's no way it can ever be a small part overshadowed by everything else. There's just no way. Lying and cheating are such huge character flaws. They are so fatal to relationships. You cannot ignore them in the face of a gazillion positive traits. They overshadow absolutely everything. They prevent love, they prevent trust, and they prevent success. They prevent healthy relationships. There's nothing here that talks about him changing or going to counseling or doing anything that you would have to do. All that's here is I love him. The second guy is holding on to hope that his girlfriend is suddenly going to change into somebody lovable when she stops being confused and gets her act together. But which part of her do you love? The part that now wants nothing to do with you? The part that verbally abuses you? Or the part that doesn't seem to know exactly what she wants? And I've had people say to me over the years, well, you know, if it wasn't for that, and that being somebody who's trying to move on. I had an email exchange with each of these letter writers. And I said to the guy, why do you want her back? And he said, because I love her. I said, you don't think that there's a good reason why she broke up with you and she hasn't taken any of your phone calls? And he said to me, well, she said she was confused. And I asked him, so you love her confusion? And he said, no, I love her and who she was before she got confused. So I said, so you don't love the person she is now? And he said to me, who she is now is not really who she is. I want you to listen to the rationalizations and justifications of these people and ask yourself, how many times in trying to hang on to a bad relationship have you made the same tepid excuses? He's saying who she is now isn't who she really is. I said to him, how do you know that? And he said, I just do. And that is what people who want to hold on to bad relationships and irreconcilable differences say. I just know it. I just do. And that's it. And you don't know. You absolutely do not know. Saying, I just do, I just love her, are just very weak rationalizations for hanging on to a dead relationship with someone who's not interested in being a healthy partner and working with you to achieve what you want. The man said to me, well, there's worse things people could be than confused. And I agree with that, of course. But if you don't draw a line at confused, you'll be experiencing worse things in the future, like the verbal abuse, like her going away, like her breaking up with you. I just did a podcast on mixed messages. The podcast right before this one, podcast episode 29, was about mixed messages. When people are confused, they give you mixed messages. And they might not seem to be horrible in the face of quote-unquote life without her. But confusion is often a gateway drug to much worse behavior that you've already experienced, like the verbal abuse. You say, well, it's not like she physically abused me. No, but she has abused you. And if you don't draw a line at that, you'll be experiencing worse things in the future. I've been around people who have said, in an attempt to minimize their bad behavior, well, it's not like I murdered someone. And that's true. It's not like that at all. But you don't have to murder someone to be guilty of bad behavior or of having done something wrong. If not, there would only be one crime in the world, and that would be murdering someone. Anything short of that would be acceptable. I'm an attorney. I have not defended any murderers in my career, but I have defended people both civilly and criminally that have to go to court to pay fines for things that don't amount to murder. In traffic court, the judge doesn't say, well, gee, you know, you were only doing a 92 and a 45. It's not like you murdered someone. The judge doesn't rip up the ticket at that point and say, well, you know, it doesn't rise to the level of murder, so you're out of here. But that's not how it works in court. And it's not like she physically abused me doesn't work in therapy, in getting healthy, in good relationships. It doesn't work. The same way, well, it's not like I murdered someone, doesn't work in court when you're in there for a traffic fine. Well, it's not like she physically abused me, doesn't work when you're trying to have a healthy relationship with a broken person. It just doesn't work. Your rationalizations and justifications only work to keep you in the dark and in denial and holding on to something that doesn't work and isn't ever going to work. The guy is saying, it's not like she physically abused me and it's not like she cheated on me. No, it's not like that at all. But she did drive your life into a ditch, and now you're broken down in the ditch, and it's dark and it's rainy, and she doesn't care. So her not murdering someone, her not physically abusing you, isn't really helping your rainy little life get less rainy. It's still raining. It's still dark. You're still in a ditch. Now the first woman, why do you want him back? Because I love him. So he's lied and he's cheated and he wants you only when he wants you. He cares nothing about what you want or what's good for you. And he has no idea how to treat a woman with respect. So what part of him do you love? This is a question that I asked her. And she said, he can be kind and funny and good to me. And I shook my head. I was like, what? Can be doesn't mean he is, and it doesn't mean he is on a consistent basis. I can say he could be all those things, but instead he's decided to act like a banana head loser. And she says, yes, but he's my banana head loser. I've talked in other podcasts and in many articles that I've written about this competition that people who are with cheaters tend to get into with the other people that are vying for the attention of the cheater. They want to win over the other people as if they're going to win the brass ring, the shining star, and you're not. Women with low self-worth are attracted to cheating banana head losers like moths to a flame. There's usually a line for good-for-nothing Johnny who cheats and lies, because all you're thinking about is the other women who want him, and you're going to win out over all of them. You're going to have the cheating liar, and bully for you. You won. Yay. What a prize you managed to get for yourself. And with this guy, I asked him what I've asked a million other people in the exact same predicament. Why do you want someone who doesn't want you? And he says, because I love her. It doesn't matter. As I have said in the YouTube video, when the person you love doesn't love you, and I will put a link to it in the show notes, the number one requirement for a relationship is wants to be with me. When that is not there, nothing is there. Even if someone is not an abuser, not a cheater, not a liar, or not confused, if he or she does not want to be with you, that's it. It's over. It's done with. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. Do not continue to make excuses, rationalizations, and justifications for someone who can't be bothered with you. The fact that you harassed her into going out with you does belong to you. You should take that lesson and you should bring it into the future and realize if somebody says, I'm not ready, I'm not ready. When someone tells you who they are, believe them. That is what Maya Angelou said. If someone tells you who they are, believe them. This woman said, I've been hurt. I was in an abusive relationship. And many times people who have been traumatized by abuse will lash out and abuse somebody in their next relationship. She hasn't worked through her trauma. She hasn't worked through her pain. And she wasn't a good candidate for a relationship. And you kind of pressured her into it. But that doesn't mean that you have to pay penance by putting up with her nonsense for the rest of your life. When someone doesn't want to be with you, whether it's their issue or your issue or the day is Tuesday or the sun didn't come out today or whatever it is, no matter what the reason, no matter what the excuse, you should listen to the fact that this person does not want to be with you. Maybe she just stopped committing, or maybe she was never committed to begin with. But if you keep hanging on, you're the one that should be committed, and not to a relationship, to a funny farm, because it's ridiculous. You saw what you did wrong. You pressured her into a relationship and you loved who she was before she was confused. It seems like she was always confused. It doesn't matter how little someone does wrong and how much they did right. If they don't want to be with you, there's no reason to keep saying, but I love her. Because the response to that is a big fat so what? They don't love you. They don't want to be with you. And if the ex is suddenly saying, oh, but I do. I do. I realize now I love you and I do want to be with you. That might feel nice and warm and fuzzy for a few minutes. But unless there have been real changes and concrete evidence that changes have taken place, that's not going to do your life any good. If you keep harassing her into coming back to you, you don't really have her. You've just beaten her down to the point where she's like, okay, fine, we'll do this. And then she gets uncomfortable and she's gone again. Leave her alone. Love is an action. And what happens here is these two letter writers, one male and one female, has said to me, but I love him. I love her. Love is an action. And if it's just something you feel, you can keep it. You don't need it. Your ex has not shown you love. And whether it's the ex's fault or your fault or whatever the reason is, you have not been treated like they love you. And you need to grab a hold of that and you need to get it through your thick skull that the way this person has behaved is not love. It's not love. And your feeling of love for some hokey reason isn't going to save this relationship. It's just not. In one of my conversations with the male writer of this letter, he said that friends of hers had posted on her Facebook page messages that seemed to indicate that she was doing well and having a good life. And anybody who knows me knows that you should not be creeping your ex's Facebook page. But if you're gonna creep your ex's Facebook page, listen to what their friends are saying about them. They seem happier without you. And I said to this man, why aren't you paying attention to what her friends are saying on her wall? If you have to go on her timeline and read her stuff, why isn't it sinking into your thick head? And he said, because I don't really trust the people that are saying it. It's like, what? He has absolutely no evidence to not trust it. If you're going to creep someone's Facebook page, if you're going to look at their Instagram, if you're going to follow them on Twitter, you can't decide which part of it you like and which part you don't like. He seems to feel like she could be a good person and a good partner if only she worked on herself. And he wants to give her time and space to do exactly that. No evidence that she's doing that. But again, I tell people, don't get involved with project people. Don't look at somebody, oh, they've got financial issues. Oh, they've got traffic issues. Oh, they have bail issues. Oh, they have this or that. I'll help them. Why do you want to help somebody who is that messed up? Why do you want somebody who is a mess and needs therapy or financial consulting or a 12-step program or maybe some medication? Why do you want that? I tend to see women do this more often than not. And one woman said to me, underneath all his problems, he's a good person. Well, great, except his problems are killing you. You're bailing him out of jail, you're fighting with his ex-wife, you're running around behind him trying to help him get a job. Another woman said to me, how can I leave him when he needs me the most? Okay, here's a hint. Open the door and walk out. That's how you leave him when he needs you the most. When you walk out the door, go to therapy and get some help for your savior complex, for your codependency, so that while you're out there, you get some help for your rescuing complex, which is just a ruse to keep you from focusing on that which you need to focus on, which are your issues and your problems and your need to pull losers out of the gutter, put them in a suit, and send them on their way. Because I'll tell you, these people are not grateful, and I have talked about this time and time again. When you fix a project person, they don't feel grateful. They feel resentful. They feel manipulated. They know that you're not truly giving of yourself, the parts of yourself that belong in a healthy relationship. You're giving time, you're giving money, you're giving energy, you're giving all kinds of things that you should not be giving. A person should have their financial act together. They should have their legal act together. They should have their employment act together before you go out with them. Stop with the fixer-uppers. Stop with the project people. Stop with the, well, you know, she's just getting out of an abusive relationship. She's got some issues and she's a little insecure and she's a little traumatized. But I'm going to go in and fix her. I'm going to love her. I'm going to love her. I'm going to love her. You are an idiot. Again. Why do you want to be with someone who doesn't want to be with you? Why are you setting someone up to resent you? Because that's exactly what happened. Robin Norwood said, when we give and give and give without it being reciprocated, it amounts to unwitting manipulation, and the other person senses it and they bolt. And they're running down the street and you're running after them. Well, wait, I just did all these things for you. Where are you going? Where are you going? They're so busy trying to hustle their little butt down the street that they're not even listening to you. Not one bit. You are strangling them with your overbearing fix-it complex. And you're thinking, I just want to love you. I just want to do things for you. I just want to help you out of your jams. I just want this to work. I. And the other person cannot get away from you fast enough. Even if they cared about you. They're like, too much manipulation going on here. And they may not be consciously thinking that. Most likely they're not. They're just knowing that the giving and the taking is so lopsided that they're going to be in debt to you forever, and nobody wants to be in debt. Nobody. They don't look at it as you're helping them because you love them, because they're in a relationship with you. They're thinking, I need to get the hell out of here. So do you love that part of someone, the part that says, I need to get the hell out of here? Do you love the part that lies and cheat? Do you love the part that feels manipulated and just wants to get away from you? Do you love the part who feels suffocated by all of your non-reciprocal giving? Do you love those parts? Because those parts want away from you as fast as possible. They're not grateful. They're not going to be grateful. And when people say, I just want our relationship to work, it's like, so what? You need two people who want it to work. And one of you has the foot out the door and doesn't want to come back. Or the person does want to come back, but they're not willing to initiate any kind of change. And the way they were the last time was complete disaster. No wonder why your best friend doesn't want to talk to you about this. Your best friend is like, nope. Blue in the face, don't want to do it, don't want to talk to you about this, don't want to watch you turn yourself inside out for this cheating liar loser. Don't want to do it. Please leave me alone. That's what your best friend is saying. I love you, but I can't handle watching you do this to yourself. And that's a good best friend. I remember I had a friend who was in this abusive relationship, and we would talk for hours and hours and hours. And finally, I got sick of it. And I remember she called me up one day and she said, Bill and I are going skiing. And I thought, You don't ski. I mean, she was the most non-athletic person I've ever met. She never wore pants. She wore dresses all the time. She accessorized to the max. She was very dainty, very almost childlike in her daintiness. She didn't have an athletic bone in her body. And now this abusive, misogynistic, crazy person is taking her skiing. So she calls me up. And this is when I was working with women in abusive relationships. And I was doing it all on a volunteer basis because I didn't have a degree at the time. And I didn't have my own therapy practice. But I did a lot of it on a volunteer basis. And I always had 6 to 10 women in my groups. And she was a friend of mine. And she would come every week and she would yada, 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 talk and talk, 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 talk. Her boyfriend was so abusive. It was horrible. He was a true sociopath. And she was one of my best friends and I really cared about her. And I understood that she was attracted to people like this because her father had been very abusive to her. Very, very abusive. That's what she knew. That was her comfort zone. And that's what she gravitated to. And I've talked about her before because I gave her the book Men Who Hate Women and the Women Who Love Them by Susan Forward. And there's one story in that entire book where the misogynist actually changes. And I actually dated somebody who was a misogynist and actually changed. It does happen, but very, very, very seldom. So I gave her that book. And when she gave it back to me, she said, "Oh, I'm so thrilled that you gave me that book." And I'm like, thank God. Finally wanted to open up her head and pour it in. But thankfully she got it. And she said, "I know that Bill's going to be like whatever the guy's name in the book who changed." And I just wanted to smack my own head into the wall. I was like, oh my God, you got to be kidding me. But I used her as an example over the past 25 years to tell people, if you want to deny, you want to justify, you want to rationalize, you can do it. Here's a shining example of somebody who did it. I mean, every terrible, terrible guy in that book was more like Bill than the one guy who changed. But who does she compare him to? The one guy who changed. Even though Bill had absolutely zero tendency to even want to change, he was a horrible, terrible person. I went there to move her out once. And she was so confused. Now, Bill was about 6'3". He weighed about 250 pounds. I'm 5'1". I weighed like 105 at the time. She's somewhere between the two of us, probably closer to his size. She was much taller than me. But she's standing in the kitchen holding an earring tray while I'm running around the apartment trying to get her stuff and pack it up and bring it down to my car while Bill's behind me screaming at me. And I'm like, get away from me, get away from me, get away from me. She's circling around in the kitchen in this confused state, holding an earring tray, and I had to physically grab her arm and pull her down the stairs to go with me and sit her in my car and then run back up. And it was this very narrow staircase where they lived. They lived on the second floor, but the staircase was very, very narrow. Very steep. And I had to run up and down these stairs with Bill screaming at me the whole time. And I said to him, one more word and I'm calling the police. And he backed off. But he was a raging maniac. And I had already done this. I did a lot of things to try to get this woman out of this relationship, including going there and getting her. Imagine my surprise when she was back there a week or so later after me putting my own safety at risk to try to get her out of there. So after all of this, after giving her the book, after moving her out of the apartment, after doing this and that, listening, she calls me one day and she says, "Bill and I are going skiing." And I went, "Oh, really? Have a good time." And she thought, mistakenly, that I was starting to see things her way. No, 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 darling. She said she realized halfway up to Vermont that what I actually was saying to her was, "Have a good time, go fuck yourself." That's what she told me. Those were her exact words when she came back. And she said she was horrified. And there she was, stuck in the car with Bill, going skiing, and she had never skied in her life. She didn't even roller skate. I mean, she had absolutely no experience doing anything like that. And he was going to be a complete asshole to her the entire weekend. And she had the light bulb moment when she realized that I was not coming around to see her side and to bless this unholy union and to think that Bill was just a hell of a guy. Nope. I was giving up on her. I was giving up. I'd done enough. I'd given her the books. I'd moved her out. I'd done this. I'd done that. I was done. Done. And that's what this woman's best friend is. This woman's best friend is, I love you. I care about you, but I can't watch you do this anymore. And I can't argue with you about this either. When people start saying, oh, good, you know, have a good time, to a relationship where they have had nothing but negative things to say about it and they fear for your safety and for your sanity, they are in effect saying, you know what, go fuck yourself. And I'm sorry to be using this crude, coarse language, but when you are with somebody and you're trying to be friends with somebody and they keep going back to kick at the football, Charlie Brown, you have to get to the point where you go, you know what, I can't do this anymore. Cannot do this anymore. So my friend said to me, I want this to work. But she could not have picked a worse part. She said, I know he'll change like the guy in the book. He never changed, and any little honeymoon period they had was followed by him changing right back. So he never really changed. He just did the little abuser's remorse, little honeymoon period just to suck her back in. That's what they do. That's what they do. And he would say to her, I don't love you. And I said to her one day, he has said he doesn't love you. She goes, oh, well, but I know that he does. She knew no such thing. He didn't show it to her. He didn't say it to her, and his actions were the furthest thing from what love should act like. Over the past 25 years, I have countless examples of this. I have countless examples of because I love him or because I love her or I know they're really a good person. If I just smooth out the rough edges, we'll all be fine. You know no such thing. Because I love him or because I love her is not a reason to stay hung up on someone who has mistreated you or who has continued to mistreat you or who is one hot mess day after day after day. And if you waded into this relationship way too early and pressured someone to be with you when they really needed time, be by themselves, and work it all out, that's on you. But you don't have to pay penance for that for the rest of your life. Realize your mistake, commit to never doing it again, and leave this person alone. Love is an action. It's not only how you are treated that says that it's love, but it's also about you and your love. Loving someone, the emotion itself, can give you a warm, soft, gooey feeling. But that feeling is worthless and meaningless if the person you quote-unquote love is not loving you back or making your life a living hell by lying and cheating or breaking up with you and refusing to talk. I have told people, you can have physical chemistry with many, many, many people, but it becomes like a drug that you're chasing, and like all drugs, it's going to take your life and your energy away. Healthy relationships are not about sparks and chemistry and toe-curling sex. It's about physical attraction that doesn't make you go off the deep end. If you have sparks and fireworks and craziness, that's usually a sign that your dysfunction is saying hello to their dysfunction. It's not good. Healthy, functional love must include physical attraction, but not physical attraction where you're totally gaga over somebody, you can't think straight, and you can't step back and objectively determine whether or not they're going to be good for you. Go to the podcast about the 3 a.m. person. Sparks and fireworks are absolutely worthless, absolutely useless when it comes to the 3 a.m. scenario. I will put links to the 3 a.m. person in the show notes. Check it out. Sparks and fireworks and butterflies mean nothing when you're in that 3 o'clock scenario. The only thing that the sparks and butterflies and fireworks do is keeping you tethered to someone who either doesn't care or doesn't have anything good to give you. Stop saying, because I love him, because I love her, when the question should be, Why do you have no standards when it comes to this person? Why are you loving someone who cannot be there for you, who clearly isn't your 3 a.m. person? Why are you not loving yourself more than you love this person? Why don't we start there and continue on? Whenever you hear yourself saying, because I love him, because I love her, think about what it is you're saying. Because the answer is probably not that much. Listen to people who truly care about you and don't have a dog in the fight like your best friend. Your friends and family are all saying, why do you give her chance after chance after chance? They're saying it because they care about you. And stop letting your guilt lead you around by the nose. Yes, you made a mistake. Yes, you tried to talk somebody into a relationship that they clearly weren't ready for. But you don't have to continue to get beaten up by this person because you made that mistake. It's time to pull back. It's time to take care of yourself. It's time to go on your merry way. Figure out what love is and what love is not. Because these two people in these letters have just described two relationships where there is not a great amount of love going on here. Wants to be with me, number one requirement. If it's not there, it's not anywhere. Forget the guy who lied and cheated. You should not get second chances for lying and cheating. One time, you're gone. Somebody being verbally abusive, one time, you're gone. Getting back out there, do the standards and compatibility inventory and figure it out once and for all. That is what you should be doing instead of playing footsie with this dysfunctional person who doesn't know how to get his or her head out of his or her own butt. Do your work, figure it out, get some standards in your life, and move on. That is what you should do, okay? If you have any questions, comments, situations that you want me to answer, talk about, whatever, please send email meanladytalkpodcast@gmail.com. And hey, you can do this. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.